it's up to us to make sure that the right content, the right information finds the right people in order to rise as it should.
What does your social media infrastructure look like today?
So organizationally, since we are so client first, that's housed in the service section, but we have dotted lines to corporate communications, PR, legal, compliance, commercial side of the business, retail. So we are truly the first example of an enterprise team within our organization.
Well, you also operate within an interesting dynamic, not least of which is a regulated industry.
Yes. I
noticed that one of the first things that you had done very well was built basically a scalable and very efficient framework for supporting social media from that regard. I mean, what was sort of the, I know the motivation, but what kind of hurdles did you have to break through to bring those types of groups together?
Gosh, I'm going to say I'm the exception to the rule. Everyone I talk to tells me they had to go through massive hurdles and leaps to get a social program off the road. And this really, it started because I got bored at work and I went onto Twitter and I typed in Suntrust and I saw massive amounts of conversations that the brand was not participating in. So I built a business case that showcased where the tweets and the posts aligned to organizationally, what processes. And somehow that deck got shared all the way up to the CIO. He sent it over to the CMO, and she called me into her office, and she said, how fast can you get this off the ground?
What was your answer?
I said, I'm ready, immediately, if not sooner. Right. So we took about 3 months to listen and make sure that we were where our clients were having a conversation, and then we built the team on the back end process. So we made sure to loop in everyone from the get-go. So legal had a stake at the table, compliance, HR, all of our LOB leaders mm-hmm. were in there. Mm-hmm. We brought them into a room and we said, this is what we're thinking of doing. These are the channels. This is what we're suggesting as a response framework. And we had it up and running in October of 2009.
This is a pretty conservative industry. And that's a pretty broad group of individuals, mm-hmm. Not to mention legal and compliance.
they love us.
I couldn't imagine them just saying, you know, let's just cannonball into the pool of social media. I mean, what were some of the real issues that you had to work through?
Some of the real issues. Our CMO, Rilla Deloria, really championed for us to open up this portal. Mm-hmm. Suntrust has historically been a very conservative bank, probably one of the more conservative ones out there. And to open up the floor, to have this honest, direct dialogue was just something organizationally at the C-suite. They weren't really necessarily prepared for that, but Rilla championed that and said it's really important. We can't say that we're a bank and we have a tagline, live solid, bank solid, but we're not talking to them about the things that matter the most to them. And money is such an emotional journey. And so to give our clients that format and that forum to have that conversation with us really broke the barriers. Legal and compliance-wise, you know, there's always the legal fine print, the disclaimers, and so they still actively, you know, we still actively work with them on marketing campaigns to run it by them, ensure that we, you know, we're abiding by the necessary disclosures. From a compliance perspective, they monitor our page every single day to ensure that the information we're distributing is correct. So they're definitely looped in. They understand the medium, so they're passionate about it.
Wait a minute. They understand the meeting?
I know. They understand it. They get it. And I am now one of the few people who can get a return email from legal and compliance in under 24 hours. Yes.
Wow.
It is. It's a big deal in my organization. It usually takes, you know, anywhere from 6 to 8 months to get an RFP process going. So far less to get an email response from them is great.
How many of the folks that served, I guess, as a social media board of advisors, mm-hmm. How many of them had personal profiles? How many of them really understood what was going on?
They have personal profiles that they shared with us.
Or that you found.
They don't want us to know about it. Less than a quarter of them, I would say. But they really took the time to delve into the medium and to understand the risks associated with this, because, of course, we are a very risk-averse industry. So they really took the time to research it and to understand it. And when we presented our response framework and then our remediation process, they felt comfortable with it because we had invited them at the beginning of this journey instead of looping them in and asking for forgiveness after the fact.
We're definitely living in a very interesting time, to say the least. I mean, not the least of which is a social media revolution, but you have the economy, and I'm sure that banks aren't sort of the heroes in this economy.
Why ever would you say that?
And then you also have a government that provides regulation, mm-hmm. But doesn't necessarily explicitly say what you can and cannot do within social media. So,
right.
I mean, some could see that as an opportunity. Some could see that as just let's stay away from it. How are you navigating those waters?
We are a bank, and as such, we're going to protect the privacy of our clients' accounts, even if they choose to discuss it in a public forum. That is our number one obligation. So, from a client service perspective, you can have that opening conversation, and then you can say to them, you know, it's really difficult for us to discuss the technical details of your account in a public format, such as Facebook. Mm-hmm. Let's take this offline. We can call you, you can email us, let us know what's your preferred contact method, and then we go from there. And sometimes we like to surprise them and just pick up the phone and call. I have a great story about a mom and a son.
I would love to hear that story. Did that start from social media?
Yes.
Do tell. Can you tell?
I can tell. So right now, we've recently announced some product changes, and our fans are passionate about our products. So we had one college student who had received the product change letter, and he basically only read the first three sentences of the letter but didn't read the ending part of the letter.
Was that 140 characters?
It was not in 140 characters, so we lost them, right? So he went onto the Facebook page, and he just started posting left and right. And, you know, we got up to 12 comments within 30 minutes. I said, you know, let's look for him. So I picked up the phone and called, and Mom answered. And Mom was the joint on the account. So that was a great conversation. I just said, listen, you know, I work with Suntrust Bank. We noticed that your son was posting on the page, and listen, I'm here. Here's my direct phone number. I want to be able to review the account with you, walk you through any concerns, address any questions. And she said, wait a minute. And then I hear her go on the back end. She picks up the phone. She said, you know, I'm just making up a name here. Michael, what did you just do? You better remove that off of the page right now. And when you get home, we're going to talk about this. And so, you know, the conversation ended well. He was not impacted by the changes, and we gave her all of the information. I gave her my personal contact information as well as our general contact information. And she said, you know what? I just think it's so great that you picked up the phone and called me. She said, and I'm definitely going to have a conversation with Michael about his social media usage. So so now the story around the bank is Bianca called someone's mom.
I have a list of people I need you to call, by the way, so we'll talk after this. But you bring up a really interesting point, because in social media, I'm sure we all can share this experience, that you sort of, what is that, ready, fire, aim. So consumers are ready to take to social channels to share what it is that they're feeling. It's a very emotional space, so mm-hmm. sometimes it's not thought through before yes. that happens. And one of those things that's not thought through is sort of the reverberating effects. We know what it happens when it's good, but when it's bad.
Right.
So Michael, you know, this person didn't necessarily realize that how 12 posts on your page was actually also reverberating within his social graph.
Right.
Do you see that at all, or do people not even care? Is it just about that one-to-one relationship at that moment?
I think within our industry, what's important to understand that money is so personal to our clients, and we're dealing with a lot of the emotional things that are behind that. Mm-hmm. So we may bear the brunt of that anger or that post on Facebook or the tweet, but if you look at their timeline or their Facebook wall, there's some other stuff that's going on. So we get to see that emotional insight, which, you know, a teammate on the phone or responding via email may never get to see that.
Right.
So we're able to then take that emotional insight. We don't relay back to them, we saw, hey, you know, you just posted that your dad just died 3 weeks ago. But we definitely use that to construct our word choice and our response in a much more compassionate manner. We go for that one-to-one because we always want them to feel that they're talking to Suntrust and never a third party.
All right. Are people really talking about their finances online?
You wouldn't believe it. All the time.
All right, so I have this, this saying I live by, and that is before you can collaborate externally, you have to collaborate within. You pulled together a great team.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that is an exceptional framework for building a social media foundation, but you're doing something a little bit different, and something like internal roadshows.
Mm-hmm.
And so what's the goal and strategy behind that, and why?
So from a teammate perspective, you know, it's great that the bank has this conversational dialogue via social media, but something that I've always remembered is a presentation by a supermarket CEO, Sweet Bates, located in Florida, and she said, what's more important, that my competitors know my plan or that my employees don't know my plan? So for us, it's really critical that our teammates know what we're doing. So I go around to all across the footprint, and I share what we're doing, and I get them excited about what we're doing, and then I invite them into the process. If they see something that we should be doing differently, or if they have any ideas, we invite them into that process. And also, with 29,000 teammates, you're also looking at a social media policy that's posted on the intranet and not necessarily at the top of mind for them, so it's also kind of a good way to say, hey, listen, I see every single mention of Suntrust that's posted publicly. and that's going to be an uncomfortable call between us if you're posting something
right.
That's not necessarily going to reflect well on the brand.
Would you say that some of that internal engagement is drumming up excitement for social media participation? And
yes.
So how are you handling that?
They are knocking down the doors. quite a few of our lines of businesses want to get in on this. But when we built this, we knew that at some point we're going to have to open up the doors to our teammates, right? But we still want to ensure that when we do open that door, that it still aligns with our business objectives and that we're able to still deliver the same level of service. So for us, it's a little bit of a slower journey, but we're going to take the small steps instead of large leaps that could lead to failure.
And are you adapting your internal framework for, I'd imagine you're not just going to turn them all loose, but maybe through some targeted pilots?
We've done some targeted campaigns and used some regional, you know, the higher volume branches mm-hmm. and had them participate. A big part of that, too, is getting the teammates to understand what's going on. And so you're having to explain to them what a marketing campaign is. And to a branch manager that has hundreds of clients coming in on a daily basis, where are they going to find the time to really understand what's going on? So that's part of the piece of the puzzle, is sharing with them what we're doing so they understand it, they can anticipate the questions, and then answer it successfully.
What are some of the things that you learned? I mean, of course, there's probably givens, but what didn't you expect?
What didn't I expect? My job ultimately is to balance the needs of the business with what's the right thing to do for the client.
Mm-hmm.
Something I didn't anticipate is that we would become what is primarily the most vocal voice of the client team that there is. So right now, as we're going through these product changes, the C-suite is actually wanting to see every single tweet, every single post. And the higher you go up the ladder, the further you get away from the client sometimes. And so you're making decisions based on analytics and data. And you're not necessarily on that phone listening to that mom at the point of sale crying because you made a decision that impacted her. So for them to be able to receive this data and to see it and to read it and to feel the emotions behind it, that's been something that I'm proud of, that we're able to deliver that.
How does a bank deal with emotions? I mean, at least from a, from a process standpoint, I mean, and then even compliance. And
yeah, I just got an unexpected gift on my desk last week. It was a little steamroller toy. Someone placed it on my desk. They're going to have to change whether or not they like it.
Right.
It's not my place to worry about how they feel as they go through that journey. But as a business, we have to deliver the service that our clients expect. And so either we're going to deliver it now or somebody else is going to deliver it a year from now.
How, well, I can't say that I've heard executives reading every single tweet. So I'm sure that's...
They're shocked, first of all, at the tone, right? So to me, I'm desensitized because I'm getting WTF'd every single second of the day, right? So it's not a big deal at all to me. But, you know, to like our president, Bill Rogers, he's like, you know, and he's like, what are they teaching them in school? I don't know. So again, you know, it's tough for them to see that feedback, but it's also really eye-opening for them, and I think they appreciate being able to actively see that data. Something that really strikes me about our CMO is that she goes out to the contact center and she listens to calls. And I think that says a lot about your C-suite leadership when they're able to do that.
Yeah, actually, a really good point, because social media, at the end of the day, I mean, even though it, most of it, at least today, is run out of marketing, it really does represent an opportunity to help the organization become much more customer-centric, mm-hmm. right? And the only way to become more customer-centric is to actually put the customer at the center of a lot of this activity. And that's actually a really good example. I'd imagine that the result of her taking time at the contact center is empathy, right? Mm-hmm. And then empathy is pretty powerful. You have emotion on the consumer side. You now have what is the beginning of emotion, on, or at least understanding,
yes.
on this side. How does that change what you do?
There are a lot of eyes on us, a lot of visibility. We are the voice and the face of the brand. So that comes with a heavy responsibility. There is no room for error, and it's something we keep, you know, it's that little angel that's perched on your shoulder, you know. Is this what Suntrust would say? You know, when we're responding, yes, it's emotional, but we also have to remember that we're representing the brand. Mm-hmm. So it's Suntrust responding, but, you know, Bianca or Veronica is the face of who's giving that statement.
Yeah, I think, what do you call that, the golden rule?
Hey, if you wouldn't say it to me in person, then don't post it online.
Right.
That's the golden rule at Suntrust. Which is why they don't tell us what their Twitter handles are. But then they mess up and they say, oh, I work for Suntrust. Yeah, you do?
Gotcha.
Gotcha.
So that actually brings up an interesting point, and that is around data mm-hmm. and insights. How are you organizing around those?
So we take a lot of the data and we tie it into our client contact center data, and we also use that to, because it's so public, we have this process called client pain points. And so we have, you know, if we have enough clients making a, you know, a ruckus over a certain process that's impacting them, we have this process where we submit it, and then there's the whole team that, you know, analyzes it and then operationalizes the change that's needed. So what we've seen with our data is that we're able to take the client pain points, because it's so visible and it's so public, and kind of move that and prioritize that enhancement quicker than it would have been just by, you know, contact center data.
And what are some of the ways that you're measuring success today, and how are you thinking about it in the future?
To me, success is when we're able to take what started out as a really tough conversation, I hate you, screw you, whatever, and have that conversation on Facebook, right? And then pick up the phone, you know, or go offline, talk with them, review the account, find the resolution that's necessary. And that client goes back on Facebook and he says, you know what, I had no idea my bank would listen to me. I thought I was just a number. So for us, engagement is really the critical piece. I know everybody wants to know the ROI, but for us, it's we're moving from a silo organization to an enterprise organization. So to have that open voice of the client built into that process as we move along that change, that to me is success.
Excellent. Bianca, thank you so much.
You're welcome.